So welcome to session two of trigonometry. So let's start from where we left off in the previous session. In the previous session, you would all recall, I had done some negative angle identities with you. Okay. So last class, we stopped at some negative angle identities. Negative angle identities. What were these identities? These identities were sine of minus theta is minus of sine theta, cos minus theta is cos of theta, tan minus theta is minus tan theta, cosec minus theta is minus cosec theta, sec of minus theta was sec of theta, and finally cot of minus theta was minus cot theta. Now, from where do these identities come up, right? So we are going to discuss today something which is very, very important part of our learning, is the graph of these basic six trigonometric functions. So from the graph, we'll come to know many things about these trigonometric functions. Not only about a trigonometric function, but how they are also related to other trigonometric functions. So all these identities that you're seeing right now in front of your board, they have all come from the graph of these trigonometric functions. Now, of course, they are ratios, but we can also treat them as functions. For example, sine of theta, you know that if you are putting in some input over here, it gives you some output. Correct? It gives you some output. Right? So why not treat this as a function itself? So why not make this as y is equal to sine x function? Okay. So we are going to give it a shape of a function, and now we are going to study its graph. So one by one, I'll be exposing you to the graph of these functions. We'll be making a quick analysis on it. And not only that, we'll also keep these graphs in our mind. Okay. So going forward, the graphs which I'm going to show you should be kept in your mind. That is very, very important part. So let me start with the graph of y is equal to sine x function. So this is the first function that we'll talk about today. Okay. Now we'll keep our x in radians. And now I'm going to show you the graph of y is equal to sine x function. No need to note down, Auro, because I'll be sharing with you this PDF. So everything would be there in that PDF. Okay. Even I'll not be plotting it. I'll be just showing you on the GeoGebra tool. So all of you, please pay attention, stay tuned. So this is GeoGebra. So graph of sine x. Let me first make a change in the dimension. So in GeoGebra, you can also change your unit in which you want to make your x-axis. For example, I've kept it in terms of radians. So as you can see, 0, pi, 2 pi, minus pi, minus 2 pi, etc. Okay. Now, I'll just show you the graph of sine x function. So y is equal to sine x. Okay, so this is a sinusoidal curve. This curve is called a sinusoidal curve. Now, $1 million question here is, how do you plot such curves? What is the reason that these curves come up? Okay, why is it like a wave? Okay, the answer to it is very simple. What I'll do first is, I will copy this graph first. I'll just copy this graph. I'll just remove this as of now. Yeah. So let's copy this graph. Okay. Yeah. So here I'll be pasting this graph. You don't have to copy anything. Okay, this is the graph. Now, what is the reason for this graph? See, let's go back to our previous class. where we had divided angles into quadrants, where we had divided in angles into quadrants. Okay. On this graph, let me make a unit circle for you. Let me make a unit circle for you. Okay. What do you mean by unit circle? What do you mean by unit circle? A circle of radius 1. Correct. So let me just show you an angle over here. Let me show you an angle over here. Okay, let me say x radians. Fine. Now, let me drop a perpendicular. Let me drop a perpendicular from this point to this point. Okay, so this is a perpendicular. So again, repeating what I have done so far, I have made a unit circle. Unit circle means this particular hypotenuse of this right angle triangle will be 1. Correct? This is x radians. Okay, so let me name it AOB. Okay. Now, what is AB length over here in terms of x? Can anybody tell me what is AB length over here in terms of x? Sine of x. Absolutely. So AB is sine of x. Okay. Now, what are we plotting here? We are actually plotting, all of you please pay attention over here. This is very important. We are actually plotting AB length versus x. Versus x. So as you change your x, let's say if you start going in a anti-clockwise direction, okay, let's say you go 30 degrees pi by 6. Okay, so when you rotate 30 degree, you know that AB length will become a half. AB length will become a half. Okay, so when x is pi by 6, AB length will become a half. So what do you do on this graph? For pi by 6, let me choose a color which you can see. Let me choose a green one. So on this graph, at pi by 6, I will plot half. Okay. So basically, you are plotting pi by 6, comma half. Okay. If you change it to pi by 3, AB length will become root 3 by 2. So as you can see here, this graph will show you that at an angle of 60 degree, your value is, I mean, it's too small for you to see here, but this value here would be root 3 by 2. Okay. So because at 60 degree, your AB length would slightly change. Now this would be your new AB length. Okay. So let me call it as new AB length. Okay. If you make it 90 degree, AB will come over here. AB will come over here. So as you can see at 90 degree, which is exactly the peak point, your value will become a 1. Right? As you go past 90 degree, you would realize, and you go past 90 degree, you would realize that AB length will fall down again. AB length will start decreasing. So your graph will start coming down. And as you go to 180 degree, or you can say pi radians, AB would have again become a 0. So you're back to this position. Right? Again, if you go to minus, you can say 270 degree, your value of AB length will become minus 1. Okay. So what are you doing? As you're rotating this, you know, particular angle about this circle, whether clockwise or anti-clockwise, AB length, how it varies, it becomes, you know, it grows to 1, then it becomes small, then it becomes minus 1, then again becomes 0, then it again becomes 1, then again becomes 0, then again becomes minus 1. So this trend has been plotted. This trend will result into this graph, and this graph is basically called a sinusoidal graph. This graph is basically named as the sinusoidal graph. Is this fine? Okay. So any question, any concerns on how these graphs have actually come about? Right? No problem with that. So for sine equal to pi by 2, AB will become a 1. Okay. And if you continue going, let's say x equal to pi, it will become again a 0. Okay. Again, x equal to 3 pi by 2, it will again become a 1, minus 1. So the value of AB has been plotted on the y-axis and your angles have been plotted on the x-axis. Okay. The same trend you'll see even if you're rotating clockwise. So clockwise is your, you know, other side of the y-axis. So that is your clockwise rotation values of AB. Any questions so far on this? Okay. Now what we are going to do is we are going to do a critical analysis of this graph. What does this graph actually convey about sine x? So what all informations can we derive from the graph of sine x function? Number one information that I can see here is the domain of the graph. Now, what is domain? People who were not there with us in the bridge course, let me tell you, domain are the valid inputs that you can put into the function. What is the meaning of valid input? Such real inputs which will make the output real, those are called the valid inputs, because we are dealing with all these functions as real valued functions. So in order to know what is the domain of a graph from its sketch or from its figure, you just have to see what is the span of the function along the x-axis. Okay, watch my motion of my hand, right? So what all values of x is the graph present for? That is called the domain. In a similar way, what all values for y is the graph present for? That is called the range. So for domain you see this way, for range you see this way. Okay, so what do you think is the domain of the graph? Let's go back to this figure. Let's go back to this figure which we had sketched for sine. If you extend the graph to the right hand side, you'll see this graph will never stop. It is going on and on and on. See, so far we reached. Same would be true even if you sketch the graph, even if you extend the graph on the negative side. Okay, so in light of this, we can claim that the domain of the graph is all real numbers. Absolutely, Anusha. So it is all real numbers. Okay, you can also call it as minus infinity to infinity. Is this fine? Any questions? What is the range of the graph? To see the range of the graph, you need to see the span of the function along the y-axis, right? If you see, your graph is extending along the y-axis from minus 1 to 1. So only in that region, the graph is present. Above 1, below minus 1, the graph is absent. Okay, so the range of this sine x graph will be minus 1 to 1 close interval. So under no condition you should expect the graph to cross 1 or go below minus 1. Okay, so sine of any angle cannot be 2 or 1.5 like that, or minus 2 or minus 1.5. Okay, they cannot go beyond 1 and minus 1 interval. Okay, another thing I can see from the graph, that this graph is symmetric about origin. Symmetric about origin. What is the meaning of symmetric about origin? Symmetric about origin means whatever you have drawn, right? Whatever you have drawn in the first quadrant, as you can see, whatever you have drawn in the first quadrant, you have drawn the same thing in the third quadrant. Okay. And whatever you have drawn in the second quadrant, the same thing you have drawn in the fourth quadrant. So think as if there is a very, very small mirror which has been kept at the origin. Okay. So if you are in the third quadrant, you can see its reflection coming from the first quadrant. And same for the second and the fourth. Okay. Such functions whose graphs are symmetrical about origin, they are called as odd functions. So let me write it in green for it to be consistent. So sine x function is an odd function. Now this odd is a term that we normally use in functions. You will study more about it in your class 12th. I think in 11th we don't talk about odd function, even function. It's a subject matter of class 12th. But just understand this. Odd functions are those functions which will satisfy this equation. F of minus x is minus of f of x. That is, if you change your input sign, your output sign will also get changed. This is precisely why it followed the property sine minus theta is minus sine theta. Now I would like you all to go back to this graph and realize this. See, let me go back to the original figure here. Yeah, okay. Now if you all see here, if I take an angle, let's say 90 degrees, so pi by 2, I get a value 1, correct? But if I put a minus 90 degree, that is minus pi by 2, I'll get minus 1 as my answer. I will get minus 1 as my answer. That means if I'm changing my sign of the input, the sign of the output will also get changed. Okay. And this is the characteristic which is shown by all the odd functions. Can somebody tell me any other odd functions that you have seen before? Anybody? Any odd functions you have seen before? X, very good. X cube. Okay, that's an odd function. In fact, any polynomial whose powers are always odd numbers will be an odd function. For example, x cube plus x, that will also be an odd function. Okay, right? So any polynomial subjected to the variable subjected to all the variable x subjected to odd powers would be odd polynomials, odd functions. Is this fine? Any questions here? Okay. Another thing that we would like here to observe by all of you is that this function is periodic. This function is periodic. What is the meaning of a periodic function? What does common sense say about function being periodic? What do you understand by a periodic function? Anybody, you can unmute yourself and talk. If somebody comes and says, hey, this is a periodic function, what do you mean by that? Okay, so Pradin is saying its values repeat after fixed intervals. Absolutely. Okay, so I say that sine function is a periodic function because I can see the values repeating after a certain interval. Okay, now let me show you something very interesting here. Zoom out of the graph. Okay. Yeah. Now, all of you, please look at the graph. If let's say I take a value 0, okay, sine x becomes 0 at 0. When is the next occasion it becomes 0? So people are saying pi, people are saying 2 pi also, and both of you are right. Okay. But if I ask the immediate next interval where it is becoming 0, you will say pi. Correct? Correct. Again, 2 pi. Again, 3 pi. Okay. So you'll realize that after a gap of pi, sine x is becoming 0 again, starting from 0. So sine 0 is same as sine pi, is same as sine 2 pi, and so on and so forth. Okay, does this mean pi is the period of sine? Yes or no? Of course, there are two answers only, and both of the answers I can see on the screen. Kshitij is saying yes, Arya is saying no. Okay, now person who's saying no, can I hear from you why, Arya, this cannot be the period of sine? Try it out. Let it be wrong. No worries. Okay. Absolutely. She has written it very well. See, my dear, try to understand here. How is a period defined? Period is basically... try to understand this. If a function is periodic, okay, with a period of t, okay, then remember one important thing that I'm going to tell you now. If you change your input by t, you are going to get back the same value of the function. Okay, for all values of x belonging to the domain of the function. This is very important. Many people, they do not take this into consideration. This repetition must happen for all values of x in the domain of the function. So when I told you 0, Zero definitely repeats itself. Sine zero, sine pi, sine 2 pi. This repetition is happening after every 180 degree jump. But do you think this will happen for other values of sine? For example, if I say sine 30 degree, that is half. Okay. Right? When is the next half coming up? Of course, next half is coming up at sine 150 degree. Okay. Again, when is the next half coming up? It is coming for 390 degrees. Okay. Again, when is the next half coming up? It is coming for, if you just add 120 to this, 510 degree. Correct? Are you getting my point? So now, this is an example where you would realize that this is showing some different nature. You can see that sine 30, of course, this is 150 gap, but this gap is almost 240. But you can say that from sine 30 to sine 390, this gap is consistent. So you can see that the next value that you'll get will be sine of 750. Okay, so this jump is consistent. Are you getting the point? So we have to take that period as our period for which your function will repeat itself for all x in the domain of the function. So you cannot take a call on the basis of one or two values of x. The best percent, the best angle to take a call here is this guy 90 degree. So at 90 it is 1. The next time it becomes 1 is at this position. Okay. Again, next time it becomes 1 is this position. By the way, this position is 5 pi by 2. This position is 9 pi by 2. Okay. So how much is this jump? How much is this jump that the function is taking? The function is taking a jump of 2 pi. Correct? Now, it could have taken a jump for 4 pi also, 6 pi also, 8 pi also, 10 pi also, 12 pi also. So there could be so many, T's possible. Or there can be so many periods possible for which the sine function or a particular function may repeat itself. Now here comes a very important fact. The smallest real value of t, the smallest real value, real positive value of t is what we call as the fundamental period. As what we call as the fundamental period. Okay. So sine x has a period of 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi, 8 pi, 12 pi, 20 pi, 22 pi, 100 pi. You will realize that it will repeat itself after that many jumps in the value of x. But what is the smallest of them? The smallest of them is 2 pi. Okay. So 2 pi is the smallest real positive t for which the function sine will repeat itself again. So sine function will be having a fundamental period of 2 pi. Are you getting my point? Now this word fundamental is sometimes dropped. So if you just say period, you should always mention the smallest value of t for which the function is repeating itself. So if somebody says, hey, what's the period of sine? He actually means what is the smallest t. Okay, now remember t is always a positive real number. It's always a positive real number. Okay, it cannot be zero. Forget about negative, it's a positive, always a positive real number. Okay, so it's periodic and its period is, or you can say fundamental period is 2 pi. Got the point? This is very important. Okay, now is constant function periodic? Because constant function will remain same throughout, right? F of x equal to 2. Will you call this as a periodic function? Just as a common sense question. Okay, Arya is saying yes. So what is the period for that? 0 can't be. I told you it's positive. T has to be positive real number. Okay, so yes, the answer to that is it is a periodic function, but its period is not defined. Its period is not defined. Okay, is this fine? Can you tell me other functions which you have come across as periodic? In the bridge course only we have talked about that function. No, cossacks, we didn't talk about cossacks in the bridge course. Na 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 Ansh, na 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 Arya, fractional part. Yes, Anusha is correct. Fractional part is another periodic function, not GIF, fraction part. So fraction part is another, you can say non-trigonometric, or you can say algebraic function, which is periodic. So it repeats itself after every, what is the fundamental period there? One. Okay, we'll talk about it. No, floor function is not periodic. Floor function is not periodic. Okay, fractional part is periodic. Okay. Now, a couple of other things that we need to know is, what are the values when sin x becomes zero? So let's do this exercise. When you think sin x becomes zero, what are the values for which sin x becomes zero? Can we find a pattern? Okay, let me take you back to the graph. What are the values of x for which you think sin x becomes a zero? I can see it becomes a zero for zero. It becomes a zero for pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi, 5 pi, minus pi, minus 2 pi, minus 3 pi. So if you have to generalize this result, what would you say? What would you say? All multiples of pi. Absolutely. This is something which you all need to remember. We'll be using this extensively in our trigonometric equations chapter. Okay. So sin x becomes zero for all values of x which are multiples of pi. Okay. Where n is an integer. This is to be remembered. Okay. It will be used so heavily that you cannot afford to forget it. Okay. When you think sin x becomes 1, let's do this as an exercise. All of you, just like we have stated a pattern over here, give me what is the, you know, pattern of the angle, okay, of course in terms of, you know, n being an integer, so that sin x becomes 1. If you want, you can look at this graph and figure that out. Pattern I want, that is one of the angles, Oro. Is pi by 2 the only angle for which sin is 1? No, right? So I told you last time, while I was talking about the periodicity, pi by 2 is there, 5 pi by 2 is there, 9 pi by 2 is there. Can you give me a formula? Can you make a formula out of it? That is what I'm trying to say. No. How are you n by 2 pi? What if you put n is 2? It'll become pi, no? Sin pi is 0. How it is 1? Okay, so somebody has written pi by 2 plus 2 pi, 2 n pi. That is very, very good answer. I like that answer actually. So some of you have written, one of you has written pi by 2 plus 2 pi. Okay, pi by 2 plus 2 pi. Is this correct? Or you can say 4 n plus 1 pi by 2. Is this correct? Let's check. Let's go back to our figure. Okay. As you can see here, the first angle where it is showing 1 is pi by 2. Next jump is 5 pi by 2. Next is 9 pi by 2. If you go further, it will be 13 pi by 2 and all. So I can see that this formula which the student has told rightly fits into this scenario. Because if you put n as 0, you'll end up getting this. If you put n as 1, you'll end up getting 5 pi by 2, which is this. When you put n as equal to 2, you'll end up getting 9 pi by 2, which is this. If you put a minus 1, you'll end up getting minus 3 pi by 2. Minus 3 pi by 2 is this part. That's absolutely correct. That is also 1. Okay. So I think it was, who gave that answer? Yeah, Anusha. Absolutely correct. Okay. So this is going to be the pattern for the angle such that sin x becomes 1. By the way, these type of expressions are called general solution. What it is called? General solution. So if I say tomorrow, give me the general solution for sin x equal to 0. What will you say? X equal to n pi. N being integer. Give me general solution for sin x equal to 1. What will you say? X equal to 4n plus 1 pi by 2, n being integer. Okay, This also should be there in your mind. Please remember this. I'm bubbling it for you so that you don't forget it. Is this fine? Okay, let's play one more game. When do you think sine x becomes minus 1? Give me the general solution. That is the word I'll be using now. Give me the general solution for which sine x becomes a minus 1. Think carefully and answer. If you want, I will take you to the graph. Minus 1. So, minus 1 I can see here. So, 3 pi by 2 is the first position. Next is this 7 pi by 2. Next is 11 pi by 2. If I go back also, minus pi by 2. Can you make a pattern out of this? So, pi by 2 if you remove, can you make a pattern out of these numbers? 3, 7, 11. Next one will be, I think, 15 pi by 2, like that. Do you see a pattern in this number? Are these numbers recognizable? Have you seen these numbers before? If not, it's an AP, absolutely. It's an AP. In an AP, if you write down the nth term, what is the nth term of an AP? It's the first term plus n minus 1 into the common difference. Okay. So you can say 3 plus n minus 1 into 4. 4 is the common difference. So your answer will become 4n. How much is this? 4n minus 1, right? Isn't it? So it becomes 4n minus 1 pi by 2. So you can say for every 4n minus 1 pi by 2 value of the angle, sine x is going to throw out minus 1 at you. So here it was 4n plus 1 pi by 2. Now here it is 4n minus 1 pi by 2. So this is going to be the general solution for sine x equal to minus 1. Okay. Again, this is to be remembered. Don't forget this. Okay. Don't worry. We'll have a full-fledged subtopic on this, which is trigonometric equations. We'll come back again to these concepts. So I thought since we were talking about the graph, we'll have a good analysis of it. So I think we have done a complete bio data of this graph. Okay. Why is this graph like this? We have understood that. What is the domain of the graph? We have understood that. What is the range of the graph? We have understood that. What is the symmetricity of the graph? What is the periodicity of the graph? And what are the special values for some angles for which sine shows certain characteristics? Okay. Can we do this for other values, right? Yes, we can. We can do this for other values. That is what is the entire chapter about. So I can tell you the general solution for which sine x is half. I can give you a general solution for which sine x is equal to root 3 by 2. I can give you a general solution for which sine x is equal to minus 1 by root 2. I can definitely give you. Okay. When the right time comes, we'll talk about it. Okay. Now, this was the beginning of the graph. So I was a little slow. I was explaining everything to you. But as the time progresses, I'll be slightly faster. So without much ado, my dear students, let's move on to the graph of cos x. To the graph of cos x. So the second trig function, not trig ratio anymore. Of course, it's a ratio, but we have made a function out of it. So let us see the graph of cos function. Graph of cos function, I'll be just plotting in the same diagram. So y is equal to cos x. Okay. So red graph that you can see is your cos x graph. If you see very clearly, or critically, you would realize that both these functions are of the same nature. Both are sinusoidal in nature. Okay. The only difference is in one you are plotting the perpendicular versus x. In other you are plotting the base versus x. Okay. So how will this base of that reference triangle going to fluctuate from 1 to 0, then minus 1 to 0 to minus 1? So this oscillation is what you are capturing on this graph. Okay. Another thing that is very, very evident is that one of the graph, or we can say there's a phase difference between these graphs, right? What do you mean by phase difference? Phase is a very, heavy word that I've used over here. Probably you'll hear that in simple harmonic motion. As you can see, this achieves its peak at, let's say, zero. That is, cos achieves its peak value at zero. Sine achieves its peak at pi by 2. Okay, you can see this peak, you know, at these places. So there is a phase difference, you can say, between these two graphs of pi by 2. Right? And you know, this is the reason for the complementary property that you had studied in class 9th or 10th. Okay, sine 90 minus theta is cos theta, correct? Or cos 90 minus theta is sine theta. Okay, so this property that you have learned, my dear, this property is basically, you know, has come from this phase difference between these two graphs. Are you getting my point? Now, let's say I want to ask you a physics question. Okay. Shitiz has a question. If two functions have phase difference of 6, can I say f of... Do you read this kind of word, phase difference in functions? Where have you read a word phase difference in functions? What is phase? It's a physics related term. Okay. No. That cannot be generalized. I'll talk about it in, you know, when we do functional equations with you in functions, but don't use that word phase there, Shitesh. That would be an incorrect word. Okay. Anusha has a question, sir, but how does the graph even have a negative sign because cos minus theta is cos theta only? Oh, that's a very deep question you have asked, Anusha. Cos minus theta is cos theta doesn't mean both of them can't be negative. Cos 120 is minus half. Cos of minus 120 is also minus half, but both are minus half, right? So why can't the graph have a negative side? Can't both negatives be equal to each other? Answer the question. So what about if the graph is odd at some point and even at some? See, the nature of the graph is not odd and even at points. It is the generic nature of the graph. It is not a nature of the graph at a given point. If a graph is odd, it is odd throughout. That means it will be symmetrical about origin. If a graph is even, it will be even throughout. I'll talk about even. As of now, we have not talked about it. It is even odd nature is not calculated at a point. It is the characteristic of the graph. Right? I am, let's say, 180 centimeter tall. If I'm at my house also, and if I go out also. My height doesn't decrease if I go out, correct? So the function characteristic will not change with different points. Of course, the value of the function may change. Characteristic wise, it not change. It is sinusoidal. You don't say it is sinusoidal at pi by 2 or it is sinusoidal at 0. We don't say like that. Okay. Now, I would like you to ask a physics question. No. It is not necessary that a function has to be even or odd. This is not a complementary division. It can be neither also. For example, x plus x square is neither. Okay. Let me come to it when I talk about this thing, even odd function. So function, all functions in this world need not be, you know, categorized under two buckets, right? It can be neither also. Getting my point? So if a graph is not symmetrical about origin, right, and if it is not symmetrical about y-axis, it is neither. Getting the point? Okay, let me come to my question. I had a question for all of you. Let me ask you that question. My question to all of you is, let me hide this. Okay, which of the two function is leading? You understand leading? If there's a phase difference, one is leading from the other, right? Which is leading? Cos is leading or sine is leading? Okay, the only two options, either cos or sine. Okay, let us say my x-axis was time axis. Okay, let's say my x-axis was time axis. Okay, so this was, let's say, time axis. Okay, right? Now, we all know that cos of 90 degree minus t, now I will call it as t, okay? Or let me write it as pi by 2. Let me write it as pi by 2. This is going to be sine of t, right? Now, since we know cos is unaffected even if you flip the position, so even if you say t minus pi by 2, it will be sine t. Now, everybody just have a close look at it and tell me which is the leading function. Okay, everybody says cos. That's absolutely correct. Okay, it's very simple. What t achieves at 0, this achieves at pi by 2, right? What this fellow, now let me write it like this. Okay, now when you put sine t and cos t, if you see sine t function and cos t function, what sine achieves at 0, cos achieves at minus pi by 2, correct? Yes or no? Okay. But now many people ask me, you can also say this as cos pi by 2 also, correct? That means what sine achieves at 0, t equal to 0, cos will achieve at t equal to pi by 2. So sine is coming first, right? At that position, sine is coming first, then cos function, correct? So won't the answer be cos function, sine function then? How do you answer this? So those who are saying cos, now would you like to change your answer? Are you getting my point, what I'm trying to say? The function which is leading, right? That function will achieve a particular value before the other one, right? Okay. So what sine achieves at 0, cos may achieve at pi by 2, or it can also achieve at minus pi by 2. If it is achieving at minus pi by 2, right, then cos is leading function. But if it is achieving at pi by 2, it is a lagging function. Are you getting what is my situation here? So Anusha is not saying, sir, neither is leading. Okay, again, see this. What sine achieves at 30 degree? Okay, so let's say 30 degree is a parameter of time. I can make it as pi by 6. Okay, cos will achieve that at pi by 3. But it will also achieve the same at minus pi by 3. So it is very difficult to tell which function is leading the other one. Are you getting my point? So please do not unnecessarily use this, term phase here. We can just say there is a difference in the two functions phases by 90 degree. So we'll not use the word leading and lagging over here. Fine. This is just a question that, you may have in your mind. Okay. So that's why I thought I would discuss about it. Now, I forgot to copy the graph. Sorry. Let me go back again. I forgot to copy the graph. So let me copy the cos graph and we'll do a similar analysis on this as we did for sine. So let me just take a snapshot. Let me put it over here. Okay. Now let us try to study this graph in more detail. The first thing that you would all notice about this graph is its domain is the same as what we had for sign. So domain is all real numbers. Okay, I'll be slightly faster. Range here would be again minus 1 to 1. Okay, this graph shows symmetricity, or it is symmetric about the y-axis. Now, people who don't know about even function, let me tell you, even functions are those functions whose graph are symmetric about y-axis. So this is an even function. Correct? This is an even function. Fine? Even function satisfy this functional equation. That means they are not affected by the negativity of the angle. So whether you put cos 30 or cos minus 30, it will give you the same result. That means even if you change the sign of the input, output is not going to change its sign. You can see it from the graph. Let's say this is your 60 degree. This value is half. So even for a minus 60 degree, it will show you a value of half. It is not going to change its value. Okay. Another thing, just like your sine function, this graph is periodic. It is periodic and the period is 2 pi. Period is 2 pi. Now, I'm not saying fundamental over here. It is automatically understood. Its period is 2 pi. Okay. Some things we'll inquire about this graph. The first being, when do you think cos x becomes 0? What is the general solution? Now look at this graph. Cos x will become 0 at pi by 2, at 3 pi by 2, at 5 pi by 2, minus pi by 2, minus 3 pi by 2, minus 5 pi by 2, and so on. If you generalize this, you can say it is becoming 0 for odd multiples of pi by 2. For odd multiples of pi by 2. Correct? So 1 pi by 2, 3 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2, minus 1 pi by 2, and so on and so forth. Okay? So we can say here, this is 0 for all x equal to 2n plus 1, or you can say 2n minus 1 pi by 2. Okay, n belonging to integer. Okay, both are fine. 2n plus 1, 2n minus 1, both are fine. This is to be remembered, my dear. Don't forget this. This is one of the most important general solution that you are going to see. This is one of the most important general solutions that you are going to see. Okay, next, when do you think cos x becomes a 1? Let me take you to the graph. Cos x becomes 1 for 0, okay, for 2 pi, okay. If you drag the graph a little bit, or let me just zoom in a bit so that we can cover all the values. Yeah. So far, no. Yeah. So if you see, look at the graph for 0, for 2 pi, for 4 pi, 6 pi, 8 pi, minus 2 pi, minus 4 pi. So what can you generalize this as? Even multiples of pi. Absolutely, Ansh. So for all even multiples of pi, you can say 2n pi. Okay. N belonging to integers. Again, this is a result which has to be kept in mind. Okay. When does cos x become a minus 1? Let's go back again to the graph. So minus 1, it first becomes at pi. Okay. Then 3 pi. Then 5 pi. Then 7 pi. Then 9 pi. Minus pi. Minus pi. Minus 3 pi. So how can you generalize this? How will you generalize this? Odd multiples of pi. Absolutely. Odd multiples of pi. So for all x equal to 2n plus 1, or you can say 2n minus 1 pi. Okay, n belonging to integer. So these results have to be, you know, kept in mind. Is this fine? Okay, so everything is now known about cos x, no problem with cos x. So without much ado, we can now move on to the graph of tan x. Okay, tan x function graph is basically obtained from sin x by cos x, right? Of course, we don't, there is no way you can divide two graphs to get the answer. Of course, we plot it. In this, we are going to plot, in case of tan x, we basically plot the ratio of perpendicular by base. It is not as simple as your perpendicular and the base in case of sine and cos. So let me show you the graph in this case as well. Okay, so all of you, please pay attention. The graph of tan x is slightly different from the others. It is not sinusoidal. Okay, it is basically a graph like this. Okay, you can see this graph will extend indefinitely up as well as indefinitely down. Okay, and there is a big break in the function where at 90 degree, 270 degree, 450 degree, minus 90 degree, etc. Okay, why is that break? Is because tan of these angles, for example, let's have a look over here. 90 degree. Okay. At 90 degree, tan is not defined. Please note this down. Don't say tan 90 degree is infinity. You should say tan 90 degree is undefined. Okay. Why it is undefined? Is because it is sine of 90 by cos of 90. And cos of 90, you know, is going to become 0 at 90. So it is an undefined expression. Never say it is infinity and all. Okay. That's a wrong way to say. If you want to say infinity minus infinity, then you should say like this. Tan of theta, limit on theta tending to 90 minus or 90 degree minus. This is infinity. Okay. This value will go towards infinity. Okay. And similarly, limit of theta tending to 90 degree plus. 90 degree plus. Okay, this is going to minus infinity. As you can see, the moment you cross 90 degree, the graph will zoom, go down. Just before 90 degree, it will be at infinity. Okay, just after 90 degree, it will go down to minus infinity. Okay, so you can say 89.99999999, that will go towards infinity. But 90.00001 degree, that will go towards minus infinity. Okay, but exactly at tan 90, the function is undefined. Okay, so you can see the range is all the way. It covers the entire y-axis. Okay, so now this is a question that I would like you to answer. Let me take a photograph of this so that we can paste it. No need to copy anything. Everything is there in this PDF. Okay. Now, look at this graph and answer the following question that I'm going to ask you. Yeah, it resembles, but they're not the same, right? It's like horse and a mule. Both resemble, but they are not the same. Okay, their characteristic is very different. The rise in tan is very, very fast. Okay, but in the rise of x cube is not that fast. Okay, yeah. So now, everybody, answer this question number one. What do you think is the domain of this function? What do you think is the domain of the function? Fast. Absolutely, Arya. Brilliant. It is all real numbers, but not at odd multiples of pi by 2. So remove a set of all points. Remove a set of all points which are odd multiples of pi by 2. Now, this curly bracket means set of points. So those set of points would be removed from the domain. That means 90 will be removed, 270 will be removed, 450 will be removed, 630 will be removed, minus 90 will be removed. All those points will be removed. So those set of points, the function is not defined for. You cannot put that as your input. Okay. Range, as we can see, it is all real numbers. So I'll not waste much time. It is all real numbers. Okay. Is this graph periodic? I can definitely see it is periodic. And what is the period? What is the period? Pi, absolutely. So period is pi. As you can see, after a jump of pi, its value is going to get repeated for all x's in the domain. Okay. So what you get at pi by 4, the same you'll get at 5 pi by 4. The same you will get for, you know, 9 pi by 4. So on. Is this fine? Even function, odd function? What is tan? Even or odd? Even or odd? Is the graph symmetrical about origin or symmetrical about y-axis? Is symmetrical about origin? Yes. So please write this down. It is symmetric about origin. About origin. Okay. That means it is a odd function. Okay. And that's precisely why tan followed that, you know, property which I discussed the other day. Tan of minus theta is minus of tan theta. Okay. Just a quick question from for you. What do you think is the general solution for tan x equal to 0? When do you think tan x becomes 0? Now, this is no question at all, because tan x will become 0 at precisely the same points where sin x will become 0, because tan x is after all sin x by cos x. So yes, absolutely correct, Kshitij, for all n pi. Okay, and belonging to integer. So please just remember this. Rest of the values, we are not going to talk about it right now. But yes, we are going to definitely talk about them in trig equations. Trig equations. Okay. Anything that you would like to know about this graph? I think we have known everything about it. Okay. Let's now move on to the graph of. Let's move on to the graph of the fourth function, which is your cosec function. So y is equal to cosec function. Cosec, we all know, is the reciprocal of sine. Okay. It is the reciprocal of sine. And I'll show you the graph as well. And we'll try to understand why the graph of cosec is as it comes. Okay. This is the graph of cosec. All of you please have a good look at it. Up also I'm dragging. It is going all the way till infinity up. And down also it is going all the way till minus infinity. Okay. Now all of you have a look at the graph. I'll ask you a few questions. You know, it will look cooler if I draw the graph of sine x along with it. They exactly fit each other. So where sine is present, cosec is not interfering except for those points where it is touching. So they are like, you know, fitment for each other. Okay. Now, can you explain me the reason for these long U's? Yes, y-axis is a vertical asymptote. There are actually so many vertical asymptotes. Okay. Now, can somebody explain me why the graph goes to infinity, comes down, and again goes to infinity? Anybody? Absolutely, Ansh. Absolutely. Okay, so the reason is precisely very simple. You know, cosec is equal to 1 by sine. Okay, now of course at 0 you cannot define cosec. Okay, but the moment you come to 0 plus, this will become a very small positive number. Right, sine will become almost like 0.000001. 0 plus angle, sine will also be a very small, you can say 0 plus quantity. So 1 by 0 plus is a huge number. Imagine doing 1 divided by 0.00001. What will be the answer? A very large number. That's why close to 0 plus, cosec graph will be almost going towards infinity. As you increase the value of the angle, let's say as you are going this way, right? Sine is increasing. If sine is increasing, overall this value will decrease. So this graph of cosec starts decreasing, it starts falling down. Okay, so it starts for this as increases, it falls down. So both will now touch each other at pi by 2. So at pi by 2, both will become 1 each. Okay, and after pi by 2, as sine falls again, cosec will be on the rise. Okay, till when will it be at the rise? Till sine becomes 0, and at 0 it suddenly becomes undefined. Now, the moment you cross 180 degree, let's say 180.00000001. Okay, sine will become a very small negative value. Okay, reciprocal of a small negative value is a large negative value. That's why down this graph will go towards minus infinity on the right side of pi. Okay, and the same trend continues. This is why this graph looks like this. One simple way to remember it is wherever you have drawn a bump, sorry for using the word bump, there would be a bump over here. Okay, so the bumps are clashing with each other. Okay, that's a way to draw the graph of cosec in case you forget. In case you forget, it's so easy to forget these graphs. Is this fine? Is this fine, everybody? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just take a photograph for this. I don't need a sine graph, so sine graph will go off. And I'm just going to stick it for your notes. Okay. Now again, we'll not stop here. We'll just do the quick analysis. Number one, what do you think is the domain of the function? So it's just as simple. It is going to take all real numbers, but not the multiples of pi. Because it is going to make sine x zero. And if sine x becomes zero, things will become undefined. So absolutely correct. R minus n pi. Absolutely correct, Padya. Okay. What is going to be the range of this function? Look at the graph. The graph will suggest that the graph is absent. If you see this graph clearly, you'll realize that the graph is absent in this zone. There's no graph in this zone. This is no man's land. Okay. So be careful while you are telling me the range. So the range is going to be absolutely. So Ansh, that is not correct. So I'll tell you why it is not correct. See, the range is going to be minus infinity to minus 1, inclusive of minus 1, union 1 to infinity, inclusive of 1. Okay. Many students will write this as real numbers minus this interval. But when you're subtracting the interval, please ensure minus 1 and 1 are subjected to round brackets, because you don't want to remove minus 1 and 1, because they should be there in your answer. Okay. So when you write a square bracket, Ansh, it is like saying that you are not allowing 1 and minus 1 to be taken by cosec, but that is not the case. Okay. What is this union? Okay, don't worry. Union means this or this. Okay, we'll talk about it in sets chapter. So this, at least you understand, R minus that gap minus 1 to 1. Okay. Don't worry, Auro. We'll talk about union intersection when the right time comes. Okay. Third thing, is this graph symmetric about origin or is it symmetric about y-axis? Absolutely. It is symmetric about origin. Okay. That makes this function an odd function. That makes this function as an odd function. And this is precisely why cosec of minus theta used to follow minus cosec theta formula. Okay. Is this periodic? Absolutely. It is periodic, right? It's periodic with a period same as that of sine. So it is periodic with 2 pi. As you can see here, whatever value it gets at, let's say pi by 2, the same value will get at 5 pi by 2, the same value will get at, you know, minus of 3 pi by 2, and so on and so forth. So it is having a period as 2 pi. Okay. We'll not talk about the general solution and all, because that is something which again we are going to talk about later on. So there's no point repeating the stuff again in the other chapter. Okay. So we'll do a quick analysis now of sec graph. The fifth one. Y is equal to sec of x. Sec of x is basically reciprocal of cos. And I will show you the property here. I'll show you the graph here. Y is equal to sec of x. And I'll put both the graphs on. See, green graph and blue graph. Again, you can see that there is a phase difference between these graph of pi by 2. Okay. That is precisely why we had learned this in our class 10th. cosec 90 minus theta is sec theta, and sec of 90 degree minus theta was cosec theta, because these graphs are suffering from a phase difference of pi by 2. This gap is pi by 2 gap. Is this fine? Okay, so now I will hide this and I'll show you something interesting in this as well. Even this behaves the same way as sine was behaving with cosec. So I'll just draw the graph of, okay, see that bump thing is again coming over here. Fine. Okay, so let me take a photograph of it. So exactly same structure, no difference. They're all U's, extended U's like this. Okay, they're all extended U's, but not parabola. Don't call it as a parabola. That's a completely different thing. So let me paste it over here. Let's do a quick analysis of this graph. Okay, you can refer to this graph and answer these questions. What is the domain of this function? What is going to be the domain of this function? Anybody? Yeah, hello, can you all hear me? Class, can you all hear me? Okay, sorry, there was a power cut, I got disconnected. Okay, now I'm back. Yeah, so what is the domain? I think most of you would have answered because I got disconnected. Absolutely correct. So all real numbers minus odd multiples of pi by 2. Odd multiples of pi by 2, because you don't want your cost to become zero. The moment your cost becomes zero, those values are not permitted inside seek. Okay. What is going to be the range of this function? You'll say, sir, the very same range that coseq had, which is minus infinity to minus one, union one to infinity. See, don't be scared of this word union. It just says you can come from minus infinity all the way till minus one, or you can go from one to infinity. That or word is written as a union word. Okay, you can also mention it as all real numbers except minus 1 to 1 interval. Okay, this function is symmetric about y-axis. Symmetric about y-axis, and therefore this is an even function, right? And this is precisely why it follows this property, cosec of minus theta is cosec theta. That means it is not affected by the negativity of the angle. Okay. So any even function will follow this particular characteristic. Okay. Fourth property, it is periodic. It is periodic and its period is 2 pi. Period is 2 pi. Same as that of the period of cos. So up till now, sine was periodic with period 2 pi, cos was periodic with period 2 pi, tan was periodic with period pi. Okay, so tan is pi period. Okay, again, sec was periodic, cosec was periodic with 2 pi. Okay, any question regarding this? Any question regarding this so far? What is this? Twice. But this is pi. How it is pi? Look at the graph. Zero, the value is one. And again at 2 pi, the value is one. So this gap is 2 pi, no? Okay. Next. So without much ado, we'll now talk about the graph of cot. That is the sixth and the final basic trigonometric function that we are going to study, y is equal to cot of x. Cot x is basically, of course, 1 by 1 by tan, but it is also cos x by sin x. Okay, this will give you a brief idea about its domain and all when we are discussing it. So let me show you the domain. Let me show you the graph of cot x. Y is equal to cot x. Okay. Now, this graph resembles the graph of tan, but of course, the orientation of this curving is different. Why it is different? See, you would realize that it is because of your transformation that you had learned in your bridge course. People who have done the bridge course, okay, this is a question for you. From tan x graph, if you want to achieve cot x graph, okay, what will you do? Of course, you know that tan of 90 degree minus theta or tan pi by 2 minus x is cot x, correct? This is a complementary angle properties. See, because of these properties, you would notice that the name has got changed. Cos is cosine. Co means complementary of sine, right? Cosec is complementary of sec. That's why the name cosec is given. Cot is cotangent. That is why it is called complementary of tangent. Cotangent, the short form is cot. Okay. So from this particular, you know, property, can we reach to the graph of cot? It's a very simple. The first thing that I would do in order to reach to this graph is, all of you please watch me doing on the GeoGebra. So I'll first hide this. Okay, let's say I just know the graph of tan. Can I get the graph of cot from this? Now see what I'm going to do. First of all, I'm going to change the sign of x. Ansh, we just saw the graph of cot x. You want to copy something from the graph of sec x? That's what you're saying? Okay. Just a second, I'll show you the graph. The last thing that we did was, this was the last thing that we did. We wrote down the range, symmetricity, and the periodicity, and the periodic period of the graph. Let me know once you're done. Everybody is waiting for you. Done? Okay, thanks. Yeah. So let's focus on this graph. Now what I'm going to do is, first step, as I'm going to change the sign of x. If I change the sign of x, this is what will happen. This is precisely the reason why cot got, you know, tilted this way. Tan was tilted this way, cot got tilted this way. Okay. Next, what I'm going to do is, of course, we all know changing the sign of x means reflecting a graph about y-axis. People who were not there in the bridge course, we did a very, very interesting concept in the bridge course called transformation of graphs. I would request all of you who were not a part of the bridge course, you please get the learner's login. Okay, I think Dheeraj sir would be the right person to guide you on that. And watch all the bridge course videos in your free time. So changing x with minus x reflected the graph of tan about the y-axis. Again, I'm doing this reflection. I'll show you once again. Okay, just watch the nature. Just have an eye on the graph, okay? I'm changing x to minus x, okay? Okay, so DC got reflected about y-axis. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to change x with x minus pi by 2. X minus pi by 2. Means the graph will get shifted pi by 2 or 90 degrees to the right. If you see, this was actually the graph of cot x. See, both the graphs are same, right? Cot x is now on. I'm now offing cot x and oning this. Both are same. You see that? So basically, these transformations comply with your complementary angle properties that you have learned in your class 10th. Okay. Oh, sorry, I forgot to copy that graph. So let me copy this. So this is the graph of cot x. So we'll do a quick analysis of this as well, and we'll move on to few questions. Okay. So yes, let's answer a few questions with respect to this graph. What do you think is the domain of this graph? Domain. Very good. So you'll say you don't want any values which will make sine x zero. So just remove those values for which sine x is zero. It doesn't matter. Numerator may become zero. I don't care. Denominator should not become zero. Okay. So you'll say all real numbers except n pi, n being a integer. Fine. What is the range of this function? All real numbers, absolutely. Or you can say from minus infinity to infinity. Just like tan. Is this function symmetric about origin or symmetric about y-axis? In short, is it an odd function or an even function? What do you think? Odd function, absolutely. It is symmetric about origin. Okay? That makes this function an odd function. That is the reason why cot of minus theta would be minus of cot theta. So if you change the sign of the input, the sign of the output also gets affected. Okay. Next is, this function is periodic. Just like tan, it is periodic with a period of pi. Cot x is again a periodic function. As you can see, 0 is obtained at pi by 2. It is again obtained at 3 pi by 2. Okay, so this gap is a pi gap. So it is periodic with a period of pi. Is this fine? Any questions with respect to these graphs? Fine. So now let us move on to some problem solving. So what type of problems can you expect on, you know, such graphical nature of these trigonometric functions? So let me start with a question. Okay. Think and answer. Do not be in a hurry. The question is there on your screen right now, which says, which of the following is the least? I'm putting the poll on. Okay. Take your time. Once you have done it, please press on the poll button. You don't have a calculator. You don't have a log table with you. There is no option for you to know their values. What we need to know is which of them is the least. That I would not tell, Shitish. Is this in radians or degrees? I will not tell. I've already talked about this in the previous lesson. If this is the question you're asking now, means you have not understood the previous class itself. Of course it is radians, my dear. Degrees, if it is, they'll put a degree symbol. No, what did I tell you? If it is degree, they'll put that small circle over there. If it is grade, they'll put a G. If they put nothing, it is radians by default. Okay. So when somebody says sine 1, he means sine 1 radian. No problem, Anusha. But you think it is that. Okay, fine. Your answer is registered. So I think 11 of you have already voted. Okay, now 13 of you have voted. Okay, so what do you think, Ansh, is the answer? You can type it out. Okay, fine. Option. Okay, fine. Okay, one person remains to vote. Is that me? No, I don't think so. I'm the host. I'm not supposed to vote. Okay. Anyways, most of you have voted. I am ending the poll right now. Okay. As you can see, maximum janta has gone with D. 36% of you say option D is the right option. A and C have got equal voting. Okay. And B is the least of them. Okay, fine. Now let's discuss it. Did I close the poll? Oh yeah, stop the share. Let's discuss this. Now, the only way you can solve this is, yeah, can you all see me? Am I audible? Can you all see me? Hello? Yeah, now it's proper. Okay. Again, there was a power fluctuation. Now this weather is very bad. This year itself is very bad, yeah. Okay, sine function. So let me just draw it. Since all of them are positive angles, I'll not go to the negative side. I'll just draw this part. Okay, now try to understand here. This is zero. This is pi. Pi is 3.14. Okay, this is 2 pi. 2 pi is 6.28. Okay, now sine three will be almost here. Let me show you. Three will be almost here. Very close. This gap is almost 0.14 gap. Right. So sine 3 value will be this. This will be sine 3 value. Okay. Sine 2. 2 is, see, this is 1.57. This is 1.57. 2 will be somewhere between these two fellows. Correct? So 2 will be somewhere over here. Let's say, roughly. Okay, rough. It is just an estimation that I'm doing. So this value will be sine 2. Of course, sine 2 is greater than sine 3. So sine 2 is out of the picture. So people who said B, oh, bye. You're gone. You're out of the picture now. Okay. Now sine 1. Now 1 is as close to 1.57 as 2 was. So let's say 1 is almost here. I mean, roughly speaking. Okay, so this gap will be sine 1. Sine 1 is still greater than sine 3. Okay, so sine 1 will have a higher value than sine 3. Sine 3 and sine 0.14 will have the same value. So 0.14 is almost here. Okay, so sine 3 and sine 0.14 radians will have the same value. 1 is definitely greater than 0.14. So sine 1 is still lesser, greater than sine 3. So sine 3 is leading as of now. So people who said option B, wrong. Sine 7 means you are almost, you can say 0.72 gap. This is 0.72 gap. So 0.72 gap will again be somewhere over here. Okay, slightly less than sine 1, but still more than sine 3. So still the winner is, the winner means the least value is sine 1. Option A is correct. Option A is correct. This is just playing with the estimation. We are not playing with, we don't know their actual values. But by just looking at their graph, we know their relative positionings. And by relative positionings, because they're all symmetrical, so we can know which is more than the other. I would not generalize this every time, I cannot say, but yes, if you feel there is a need, for example, in this case, how would you solve it? Right? Graph, or probably you'll try to make a, you know, a reference triangle and try to compare their perpendicular lengths and all. Okay. So graph is obtained from the same fact. So why don't we use that? Correct? Okay. So sine 3 will be the least of these three. Okay, let's try another one. Good question to start with. Now this is a multi-correct question. For real values of theta, which of the following is or are positive? So any real theta, if you put, which of the two or which of the three or which of the four will always be positive? Yes, Ansh. What's your question? Again, sine 0 and sine pi was repeating, right? Was the period pi? Does it hold for all values of the domain? That defines the period, right, Ansh? Don't confuse period with a value, some intermediate value. You should repeat consistently for all the values. That is period. As I told you, sine 30, sine 150 is also the same. So will I say 120 is the period? No, because it will fail for 90 degree. Probably it will fail for 60 degree. Okay. So does it make your sense? Okay, got it. Fine. Okay, let me, I'll not put the poll for this because multiple options are correct. So I can see answers coming from Shitij and Anusha so far. Oh no, Shitij has changed his answer. None of these are correct. Okay, very good. Shitij will challenge the JE board, National Testing Agency. Okay, what if I say some of them are correct? Okay, Gurman, very good. Everybody should participate. Arabi? Yes. Okay, let's discuss this. This is not a rocket science. It's a very simple concept. See, you know that cos of theta or sine of theta, whatever you talk about, they always lie between minus 1 to 1. Okay, this is the range of these functions, right? Sine theta also, no matter whatever theta you put, 1 million, 1 trillion, minus 1 million, 1 billion, the range of these functions will always be minus 1 to 1. Okay. Now, if I ask you this simple question, cos of any angle phi which lies in this interval, let's say now this is your angle which lies between minus 1 to 1. Now, when nothing is mentioned, it is radians. So, cos of, let me show you the graph of cos again. Okay. This is the graph of cos. Correct. So, this is 1.57. This is minus 1.57. I'm just writing pi by 2 and minus pi by 2 in terms of decimals, approximately. Of course, we cannot write it completely. One is here, my dear. Almost here. Okay. Minus 1 is here. You can see cos of 1 and cos of minus 1 will have, or between them, all the values would be positive. Do you see this? Okay, so cos of cos theta or cos of sine theta will always be positive. We cannot say the same about sine of cos theta because sine graph is like this. Sine graph is like this. Okay, so let's say 1 is here, then minus 1 is here. So you can see from 0 to minus 1, you can have negative values. So I cannot say definitely they'll always be positive. So these two are ruled out. Option A and D, A and B can only be the answer. Correct. Yeah. Absolutely. Auro. Is this fine? Okay. This could be a simple question for you. Okay. Next thing that we are going to talk about is a graph-based question. Okay, I hope you can read this question. The question says, which of the following is or are correct? There are multiple options that can be correct. Okay. Now, what I'm suggesting you is, let us try to solve this option by option. So option number A, do you think is this correct? Just write your answer as A dot true or false, whatever you feel. Okay. Then we'll discuss. Read the question very carefully. Tan x to the power ln, this is ln by the way. Ln means log to the base e. Tan x to the power ln cos x is less than cot x to the power ln cos x. For all x lying between pi by 4 to pi by 2. Is this information correct or is this information not correct? Take your time, don't be in a hurry. Kshitij and Aditya have replied. Okay. Take your time. Don't be in a hurry. This is a JE advanced question. Okay. Okay. So as of now, I can see 4 responses and all of you have given the same answer. Okay. Can I expect answers from others or you have given up? Oh, no problem, Aditya. Okay, let's discuss this, guys. Let's discuss this. This is a very, very good question that we have with us. See, look at the exponents. They are same in both of them. Okay. Bases are, of course, different. One is tan, other is cot. Okay. Now, in the interval 45 degree to 90 degree, which is more? Tan is more or cot is more? Now, the answer to this can be easily obtained if you draw their graphs on the same XY coordinate system. For example, this is tan and this is cot. Not very accurate, but I'll just send those there. Okay. Yeah. So this is your pi by 2. This is your pi by 4. They'll all meet at pi by 4. Now, which graph is at a higher level? More means at a higher level. Which is at a higher level only in this gap? Only in this gap, which is at a higher level? You'll say, of course, tan. Of course, tan is on the higher level, right? So now, many people, just because they have the same power and this base here is higher, they think it is false. But wait a minute, the game is not over. Look at the power's nature. This is basically a negative quantity. Why negative quantity? Because in this interval, because when your x is in the interval pi by 4 to pi by 2, your cos x will be in the interval 0 to 1 by root 2. In this interval, ln of something is known to be negative. Ln first becomes a 0 at 1, right? So before 1, that is between 0 to 1 gap, it is negative, right? So you are dealing with a negative power, my dear. Understand this. You are dealing with a negative power. Okay. Now, I'll take a dummy scenario. Let's say tan x is 3 and let's say cot x is, I'll just take a dummy value, let's say 2. Okay. If I raise it to a power negative half, even this I raise it to a power negative half, I'm just taking a dummy sample example just to test myself. Which one do you think is bigger? Now, this is a grave mistake that most of you have done. Actually, cot x to the power ln cos x would be bigger. As you can see, this is 1 by root 3 and this is 1 by root 2. Since root 2 is lesser than root 3, overall its value is higher than 1 by root 3. So the first statement is actually true. Gone. So those who have written false, negative 1 you got. That's why think. Don't be in a hurry to answer. Don't be in a hurry to answer. Okay. So even though tan x is bigger than cot x, base is bigger for tan as compared to cot, but the power is negative, na? If the power is negative, that will change the game altogether. Right? 4 to the power minus 1 is more or 3 to the power minus 1 is more? Of course, 3 to the power minus 1 is more. Got it? Okay. None of you said true. So everybody got a false. No worries. Try B1. Now tell for the B. I think this discussion will, you know, open up your mind while you are answering it. Look at B and tell me B is true or false. Again, ln is also there. ln seek. Look at the interval you're dealing with, 0 to pi by 4. Now everybody is taking time. Okay, that's good. Should all think and then answer. Okay, Kshitij, please write your answer as B dot so that I know you are answering for B. Okay. Okay. Aditya, good. Kshitij, okay, we'll see. Nobody else wants to answer? Only Kshitij and Aditya so far? Okay, Gurman. Okay, Ansh. Okay, Parvati. Okay, Aditi. Okay, fine. Good. I liked the way you're trying. Very good. Everybody is giving response as far as possible. Some of you are very consistent in answering. Right or wrong, it's a different thing here. Trying is important here. See now, you again see the powers are the same. Okay. But this time, these powers are positive quantities. Why? Because seek from 0 to pi by 4, if you just recall the graph of seek, it is like this. So from 0 to, let's say this is pi by 4, you are from 1 to root 2. You are from 1 to root 2. So you are from 1 to root 2. So the moment you have crossed 1, ln of that will be positive. Okay. So let it be, you know, anything. Let's say it is, 0.5 only. Okay. Let's say this is 0.5. Now in the base, sine and cos, which is more? Of course, cos will come down like this, sine will go up like this. So they meet at pi by 4. So from 0 to pi by 4, cos is more. Correct? So the base here is more. Okay? So you tell me, when I'm talking about, let's say, x to the power half. Correct? The more is the x, the more is the value, right? Yes or no? Yes or no? Just try to recall the graph of root x. I'm just giving a dummy example. This is a graph of root x. The more is the value of x, the more is the value of x to the power half. It doesn't matter even if it is less than 1. Because it's an increasing function. It's an increasing function. Yeah, sure, Arya. Thank you so much. Okay. So, when you say sine x is greater than cos x, sine x to the power ln of sec x is greater than, this is a false statement. Because cos x has a higher value. Right? Correct? If you don't believe me, we can just plot it also and check. Let me just go and plot it. Okay. So, y is equal to sine of x to the power of ln sec x. Ln sec x. Okay. And the other way is y is equal to cos. This we have to put on the bracket as a whole. I think that takes that only. Anyways, yeah, so cos x to the power of ln sec x. Okay, now it's a very, very close call. I'll just put 0 and pi by 4. So x equal to pi by 4. Okay, if you see this interval, I'm just zooming in. Okay. Now this was the orange one was the graph of sine, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. Which one do you see is higher? I can see cos x to the power ln x being definitely higher. You just see this upper part. I'm zooming in more. Now see this, everybody. This guy is at a higher level. This is higher. Higher means it is more. Correct? This is pi by 4 and this is 0. Right? So this guy is the winner. This guy is higher. Right? And what does your option say? Your option says sine x is higher, which is wrong. So this is the false option. This is a false option. Got it? Can you plot it, Anusha? If you can plot it, then take a bow. If you can plot it, then I mean nothing like it, nothing in comparison to that, right? But can we plot it? That's the $1 million question. I cannot. Sine x to the power ln sec x. Oh my god. It's not those, you know, regular functions. If we can, we can definitely go for the plotting. But the problem is we cannot plot it. I can just verify it on the GeoGebra, but you will not have a GeoGebra in your competitive exams, right? Okay. If you know a bit of calculus, probably it may help you. Calculus may help you. We'll talk about it when the right time comes, when we learn calculus, when you learn about the increasing, decreasing nature of functions. Meanwhile, C. What do you think for C? Is it true or false? Just write your answer as C dot. It is not by the slope that we judge. It is by the positioning. One was below and the other was above. So what is above is higher, right? What is below is lower. C, what do you think? True or false? Now remember, the bases are same, powers are different. Okay. Again, there's a mixed response coming from the class. But most of you are saying true. Okay. Oh, that should not influence your thought process. Okay, Priyam, Shitesh, Parvati, Oshik, Aditya, very good. Now, this is a sitter. This is actually a sitter. You should not drop it. Seek pi by 3 is 2. Everybody knows it. Okay. Now, this guy is a positive number. Okay. Let's say 0.5. Okay. But this guy is a negative number. Let's say minus 0.5. Let's say I'm just taking a rough estimation. Which is more? Of course, this is more. Correct? In other words, if you take graph of 2 to the power x as your reference point, it's an increasing function. If I put more input, then my output will also be more. So what I get for putting minus 0.5 will be lesser than what I get for putting 0.5. So more the x value, so this is basically 2 to the power x graph we have plotted. More the x value, more will be the value of 2 to the power x. That's very obvious. We all know the exponential function graph. So this option is a true option. Okay. So here you realize that how, you know, shrewdly the question setter has mixed the basic idea of your graph along with your trigonometric ratios, along with your trigonometric functions. D1, is it true or false? Again, put your answer as D dot true or D dot false. Okay, Parvati. Very good. Okay. Again, this is a 1 second answer. Power is negative. Of course, powers are same also, but they're negative also, right? When powers are negative, the one with the least base will have the higher value. So half and 3/4, half is the least of them. Half is the lower, you know, lesser of them. So this will have more value. So this statement is again a true statement. Why false? Why false? Okay. Any question here? When the power is negative, you know the one with the least base will have a more value. Okay, no problem. So this is a very good exercise that we had. Now we are moving towards supplementary and complementary angle properties. Now we are moving towards supplementary and complementary angle properties. Then we'll take a break. Complementary and supplementary angle properties or supplementary angle identities. Now, we all have learned in our class 9th and 10th that sine 90 minus theta is cos theta. Cos 90 minus theta is sine theta. Tan 90 minus theta is cot theta. That's the main reason why these trigonometric ratios were called complementary to each other. Cot 90 minus theta is tan theta. Cosec 90 degree minus theta is sec theta, and sec 90 minus theta was cosec theta. This is what we had learned in our class 9th and 10th. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to scale up on these properties. I'm going to scale up on these properties, and I'm now going to ask you the next question, which think very carefully and answer. What if I ask you these following set of questions? What do you think is sine 90 plus theta and cos 90 plus theta, tan 90 plus theta, cot 90 plus theta, cosec 90 plus theta? Don't answer right now. We'll take up one by one. Okay. What do you think is sine 90 plus theta? In terms of theta, in terms of theta. Don't say sine 90 plus theta is sine 90 plus theta only. In terms of theta only, okay? Of course, some trigonometric ratio and theta. What is the answer in this case? What do you think? And how do you get this? Now, let me tell you, it is not as the previous class exercise that we did. Because if you want to know this value from your previous class experience, you would need to know your theta here. So we can't know the quadrant because we don't know theta, right? When you don't know theta, you don't know the quadrant, hence you don't know the sine, correct? And you also don't know the reference angle. So how would you solve such questions? It is just a theta in general. It can be anything. It can be 100 degrees. It can be 5,000 degrees. It can be 2 million degrees, right? So how do you solve such questions? Minus pi is not, as I told you, Anusha, period can never be a negative number. You can subtract a period from it, right? But period is always 2 pi. We never say period is minus pi. But period of sine is 2 pi. So how would 180 degree lead to this? Kshitij, how? How did you get that figure? Then theta is 90 minus, and then okay, you have actually caught your ear like this. Arey baba, one simple step you had to do: change theta with minus theta here, and you're done. Many people did not see what I wrote over here. Identity, this word itself speaks volumes. Identity means you can play with that angle theta. So you can do anything to that theta. Identity means this is like a box here. Whatever you want to put in this box, you have to put the same thing here. In place of theta, if I want to put 1 million degree also, I can put. I can put minus theta also if I want. I can put 5 theta also if I want. This is the meaning of identity now. Correct. So if you change your theta with minus theta in all the left-hand side expressions, whatever is the right side is what is your answer. So your right-hand side will be cos minus theta. Cos minus theta is just cos theta. So answer is cos theta for this, nothing else. Okay. So by this now you can answer all of them. So let's answer quickly. So the next one will be minus sine theta. Absolutely. This one will be minus cot theta. Now remember your negative angle identities. That will help you out over here. This will be minus tan theta. This will be again sec theta. This will be again minus cosec theta. Okay. Is this fine? Okay. Let me scale this up. Let me scale this up. Let's see whether we are able to tackle that. What about if I just include 180 minus theta? Okay. Cos 180 minus theta. Now that you know the trick, you should be able to tell me fast. Okay. The faster you tell me, the faster we can have a break. I'm sure most of you would be hungry also. One simple trick you have to tell me from where we can get the answer. Don't have to, you know, give me the answer for all of them. What is that simple trick that you will follow by which we can get the answer for this pretty fast? Pretty fast. hint is lying in the second set of identities. In fact, I mean, just opening it up for you to use anything you want. What would you do What is that? Anusha, I didn't get your question, da. Replace theta with theta. Yes, we can do that. Why not? But is it helping you? Does this help you? No, Ansh. No. Sine 2 theta is not 2 sine theta. Definitely not. In that case, sine 60 would have been 2 into sine 30. So sine 60 would have been 1. It is not, right? Okay. Yes, who will tell me a simple act of replacement? Your answer is already there in front of your screen. You just have to replace your theta with something and you get your answer. It's not striking you. Absolutely, Gurman, that's the answer I was looking for. In this theta, my dear students, if you replace this theta with a 90 degree minus theta, won't it become 90 plus 90 minus theta? Won't it become 180 minus theta? So this series can be taken up care by this. So it'll become cos of 90 minus theta, which is sine theta back. Okay, you can do the same for others. I'm just quickly writing down the results for you. This will be minus cos theta. This will be minus tan theta. This is just the reciprocal of the first one. So you can just write, you know, cosec theta. Okay, this is the reciprocal of the second one. So minus sec theta. And this is the reciprocal of the third one. So minus cot theta. Okay, so you don't have to remember anything. Everything is coming from retrospection. Retrospection means whatever you learned in the past is helping you to solve the present. It's not like a rocket science. Okay. Now I can continue with this exercise on and on and on and on. Right? I can give you now 180 plus theta. I can give you now 270 minus theta, 270 plus theta, 360 minus theta, 360 plus theta, 450 minus theta, 450 plus theta. But till how much will I go? There is some, you know, limitation where I have to stop myself, right? I can't sit. I cannot tell you everything. So I would now tell you a trick here to get the answer very fast. It's just a trick, okay? Don't apply logic to this trick. I'm just giving you a trick to get these answers fast. See, the problem here that is arising is we don't know theta. We don't know in which quadrant it lies, right? So when nothing is known about theta, there is very much unsurety about the sign and the expression, both sign and the magnitude both. Okay. If theta is known to you, there is nothing to worry. Then you can apply your previous class concept and sail through, right? But the problem here is, boss, theta is unknown. Theta gotilla. What is theta? How will I solve this? Okay. So how do I crack such problems? So for that, I have figured out a simple trick. Okay. And let's say even if you're going by this approach, then you have to always rely on the previous result to see the next. So let's say if I asked you this question, what is sine of 630 degree plus theta? How will you answer this? Then will you start your journey from sine 90 minus theta and make your way up to sine 60 plus theta? That would be like, you know, half an hour you'll waste there. So how do you solve such questions? I'll tell you a trick for that. Trick is very simple. All of you, please listen to this. Don't apply logic to it. Okay. Assume your theta to be some acute angle. Assume it to be an acute angle. Now here itself, most people will stop me. Sir, theta can be anything. Why acute? It can be. It's just a trick. Just a trick. So calm down. Just a trick. Okay. Just assume it to be acute, else you will not be able to figure out anything. Okay. So it's just a trick. You can say a fast way to get to the answer. Okay. Assume it to be acute. Let's say 60 degree. Okay. Say 60 degree. Now you tell me 630 plus 60. Of course, 690. Which quadrant are you in? Which quadrant are you in? Fast. Quadrant, you should tell me fast. 690, which quadrant? Fourth quadrant. Correct, Shitesh. So you are in the fourth quadrant. In fourth quadrant, sign is negative, right? So put a negative here. Half the work is done. Okay, put negative here. Okay, now listen. 630 is an odd multiple of 90 degree. It is basically 7 into 90, right? Odd multiple. If this is odd, then make the complementary of sign and write over here. So complementary of sign is cos. Cos of what? Of this angle theta. So this is going to be your answer. Done. Got the point? Okay. I'll apply it to this one, the one which you have just now seen. Let's say I want to find out what is tan 180 minus theta. Okay. You already know the answer, so you can verify it. So first of all, I'll assume theta to be acute. Let's say this is some acute angle. Let's say 30 degree. So 150 degree will lie in the second quadrant. Second quadrant tan is negative. Correct. Now this is 2 into 90. Now remember, sorry, I forgot to tell you this. When if this is even, then you have to retain the same trigonometric ratio. So it will remain tan of this angle theta. Same, simple. So minus tan theta is an answer. Don't include minus here. Okay, this minus is not to be included inside. Only theta has to be included. Okay, so this is a working rule which I have told you. If you follow this, you will never make a mistake. If theta is known, nothing like that. Right? I'll give more examples, Aditya. If theta is known, then you follow your first class method. The method which we discussed in the previous class. But if theta is not known, okay, it's an identity or kind of a thing that you want to figure out, then you can follow this. Okay, let me give you one more scenario. Let's say cosec of, let me give you 810 degree plus theta. Okay, fine. So see, how will I tackle this? First of all, I'll take theta to be some acute angle. Okay, let's say 45 degrees. Anything you want. It's your call. Now 855 will lie in which quadrant? Tell me fast. 855 will lie in which quadrant? Second quadrant. Very good. Second quadrant. In second quadrant, we know cosec is positive. So write a positive. Okay. Now. This fellow 810 is 9 into 90. So what is 9? Odd number. Correct? So what is the complementary of cosec? Sec. So your answer will become sec theta. Done. Over. Isn't it very cool, no? So it saves a lot of time for you. You don't have to start your journey from 90 minus theta and then, you know, keep moving forward. And you can test it out. It'll work. It is definitely going to work. Right? So if somebody asks you what is cosec 855 degree, okay, let's do this as an exercise. Cosec 855 degree. You know, it's the second quadrant, so positive. What is the reference angle over here? Okay, let me now go back to my first class approach. What is my reference angle here? So for reference angle, I have to see as a nearest multiple of 180 degree. So 855 degree. If I'm not wrong, it is 5 into 180 degree minus 45. Correct? So 45 is the reference angle. So your answer will be same as cosec 45. Okay. So your answer would be the same as the answer that you have got over here. Sec 45 and cosec 45 have the same values, 1 by root 2, 1 by root 2. Getting the point? Okay. Let's say I've taken 30 degrees. So let's say I want to figure out what is cosec 840. What is cosec 840? As per my identity, my answer should be sec 30. Sec 30 is 2. Correct? Let me figure out from here. So in this case, 830 could be written as 5 into 180 degree minus 60 degree. Correct? If I'm not wrong, 840. My bad. 840. Okay, so your answer would be, of course, positive sign, but positive cosec 60. Positive cosec 60. Oh, sorry, this is not 30. This is root 2 by root 3. my mistake. So this will be also 2 by root 3. Okay, both answers would be the same. Both answers would be the same. Is this fine? Yeah. See, it is not how, it is again by the, you know, positioning of your reference triangle. This is not a rocket science. They come from the reference angle point of view. Okay. So when you are dealing with an odd multiple of 90 degree, you are always in these positions, this position or this position. Correct. So your reference angle always looks like this, right? So what is sine becomes cos, what is cos becomes sine, what is sec becomes cosec, what is cosec becomes sec, what is cot becomes tan, what is tan becomes cot, right? So it is basically that these two triangles are similar. See, whatever is this angle, this is the same angle. Okay, so whenever you are realizing that you are dealing with an odd multiple of pi by 2, your reference triangle will be basically, you know, attached with the y-axis. That's why these complementary switching happens. That is why this complementary switching will happen. Is this fine? So this working rule, everybody's clear? Let's take few questions. Let's take this question. This is a prove that question. So I think just tell me done. Yeah. I'll give it Ansh. Let me just have few questions. Then we'll take a break. Done. Here you can follow any of the two methods that you have learned. You have already learned trig ratios for, you know, any angle given to you. Of course, it should be coterminal and allied to your known angles. So you may treat this as minus sine 4, 420. Okay, you can first apply your basic negative angle identities. This will remain as good as cos 660 and this is sine 330. This is your LHS. Just type done once you're done. Now you can treat as if you have written sine 360 plus 60. Okay. This you can treat it as if cos 360 plus 90. This you can treat it as cos 720 minus 60. This you can treat it as sine 360 minus 30. Okay. Then you can apply it to your complementary and supplementary angle properties. So sine 360 plus 60, of course, this is even multiple of 90. So it will remain minus sine of 60 degrees. Okay. Again, this is even multiple. All of them, I think, are even multiple of 90. So you will retain the same trigonometric ratio for this angle, but be careful about the sine. Okay. Sorry, I made a mistake here. This is 30. Slip of pen. Okay. So you are in the first quadrant and this is even multiple of 90. So cos of 30. Again, this is in your fourth quadrant, even multiple of 90. So it will remain cos 60. This is again fourth quadrant. But sine is negative there, so you'll put a negative over here. So this will become a negative value. Okay, and it will be negative sine 30. Okay, putting the values, it becomes minus root 3 by 2 into root 3 by 2 minus half into half. So this is minus 3 by 4 minus 1 by 4. Answer is minus 1. Okay, that's how you get your RHS. Okay, now we'll take a break. I think most of you would need a break now. Let's break now and we'll resume at 6:26 p.m. Is that fine? 6:26 p.m. All right. So the next thing that we are going to talk about are your identities. Now we have actually, you know, started with the main part, which is, you know, slightly complicated. You would have already done identities in class 10th, right? So I'll just test you on your basic identities. Now, identities are a very, very big concept in trigonometry. You learn about compound angle identities where more than one angle is involved. You'll talk about multiple submultiple angle identities. We'll talk about conditional identities. There's so many things which are involved with identities in trigonometry for you in class 11th. So I'm going to just begin the session with your basic identities. I want to test whether you all are, you know, absolutely fine with those identities or not. So the parent of all identity is this Pythagorean identity, right? And they are derived Pythagorean identities. So when you divide it by, let's say, cos square, you end up getting 1 plus tan square x is equal to sec square. This is another identity. All of you are aware of it. And if you divide the first one by sine square, you end up getting cot square plus 1 is equal to cosec square. Okay. So this is what you had already done in your class 10th. Class 10th basic identities, right? Now I would begin the session by asking some questions to you just to see whether you are fine with those identities or not. Okay, just to test you whether your understanding is proper with respect to these identities. So let me just ask you some questions. Okay, let me start with this question. It's a very, you know, simple question. Okay, question is, tan theta plus sec theta is 1.5. Find the value of sine theta, tan theta, and sec theta. Just let me know once you're done. If tan theta plus sec theta is 1.5, find the value of sine theta, tan theta, and sec theta individually. Okay, wonderful. Okay, Anusha. Auro, very good. Okay, let's discuss this. This is a very easy question. I think everybody should get the answer for this. Now, if you know tan theta plus sec theta, one thing for sure we all know from the second identity is secant square theta minus tan square theta is 1. Okay. This actually can be factorized as sec theta plus tan theta times sec theta minus tan theta. Correct? Now, this value is already 1.5. So, this is 3 by 2. So, 3 by 2 sec theta minus tan theta is equal to 1, which means sec theta minus tan theta is 2 upon 3. Now, This is, let's say, your first equation, and this is, let's say, your second equation. Can we use these two results to find the value of the other trigonometric ratios? Of course. Let me write that down also along with the same term. Okay. Let's add them. If you add them, you get 2 sec theta is equal to 2 by 3 plus 3 by 2. If I'm not mistaken, that's going to be 13 by 6. So sec of theta is going to be 13 by 12. All of you have got this value? Excellent. Very good. Very good. So if sec theta is 13 by 12, we can use any one of them to get the value of tan theta. So tan of theta would be nothing but 3 by 2 minus sec theta. 3 by 2 minus sec theta. Minus sec theta will be this. Correct? Right? So what does this give you? 36 minus 26. That is 10 by 24. That is 5 by 12. So tan theta is 5 by 12. Okay. Now all of you, please understand here, the moment you are getting tan theta as a positive quantity and sec theta also as a positive quantity, it clearly indicates that your theta is in the first quadrant. Right? If it is not in the first quadrant, you cannot get both of them positive. There is no other quadrant where both of them are positive together. Okay. Now, why I'm saying this is because I've seen many people, they disregard this sign. They disregard that quadrant in which your angle lies. Now, to get the value of, let's say, sine theta, many people will do this. So, sine theta, what is sine theta? Sine theta in this case would be tan theta into sec theta. Correct? Sorry, tan theta by sec theta. Sorry, my mistake. Tan theta by sec theta. Correct? So your answer will be 5 by 12 divided by 13 by 12. Okay? But however, I've seen many people doing this way. They'll start with the formula of cosec square theta. Cosec square theta is 1 plus cot square theta. Okay, that is absolutely fine. So you can use this formula and cot square will be 12 square by 5 square. So if you just take the LCM, it will get 13 square by 5 square. Okay. Now, when cosec square theta is 13 by 5, let me write it 13 by 5 the whole square. There could be two possible values of cosec theta. One could be 13 by 5, other could be minus 13 by 5. Many people simply disregard this. That leads to a faulty result. Here you are safe because you're dealing with first quadrant. Okay. Many people I ask, what is cos theta? Cos theta is, sir, under root of 1 minus sine square theta. That means you're always saying cos theta is positive. Always cos theta is positive. Because if it is under root of something, it must always be positive, right? Is this the right way to say? You are actually confusing between these two expressions. They are not the same, my dear. So it could give you both plus minus. Yes, that is the right way to deal with it. People always say that cos theta is under root 1 minus sine square theta. Under root. See, if you're saying that, my dear, you are labeling that cos theta can never be negative. That's a wrong thing to state. Okay. So in this case, you are safe because theta is in the first quadrant. So from here, we can get sine theta is equal to 5 by 13. Okay. So this process is good enough. But if you're using this process, be aware of the quadrant. Okay. So sine theta is known, sec theta is known, so cos theta will also be known, 12 by 13, not an issue. Any questions here? Let's take another one. I hope you can all see the question. Okay, so this is a single option correct question. I would run the poll for this. Okay. Please mark the poll after you have solved it. Take your time, don't be in a hurry. Take everything into your consideration before you're marking any answer. I hope you can all see the poll, right? Okay, then in that case, Parvati, you can write down the answer on the chat box itself privately to me. Okay, three of you have already voted. Okay, Anusha. Okay. No, only you have submitted. How many board exams are pending, Auro, for you? For others? Oh, okay. I think Rajaji Nagar is going to have it on June 15th or something. I'm not very sure. Others are going to have it in July. Oh, you want off? You want a break? So much peace you are having at home, yeah. No school and all. Only centum class you're doing. Oh, because it is in the evening you're saying it. Oh, because of the lockdown. But nowadays I'm seeing, you know, children have started coming out in the common area playing and all. Yeah, a few grounds have opened up. Correct. That's correct. Yes, I can see 8 of you have voted. Please fast. 2.5 minutes have already gone. In another 20 seconds, I will close the poll. 20 seconds. Okay, at the count of 5, now I'll close. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. So, maximum janta has voted for option B. Okay. And then the next highest has gone to A. Okay. So, let's see whether janta is correct or not. Now, this is a expression which you would have seen million number of times in your class 10th. So, there is a stereotypical approach for this. What do we do in this case? Inside the bracket, we multiply and divide with this. Okay. Same thing we'll do, or in fact, you can say similar thing we'll do with this. We will multiply and divide with 1 plus cos alpha. Okay. Now, this will lead to 1 minus cos alpha the whole square and lead to sine square alpha in the denominator. Okay. So, you can just say, it is basically square of this under root. Okay. In a similar way, here you can also say it is 1 plus cos alpha by sine alpha square under root. Okay. Now remember, my dear students, this is from the bridge course again. Okay, just recall. Not very far away when we did this concept, under root of x square is actually mod x. People who have a habit of cancelling square and square root, this is for you. When you're doing a square root of a positive of a square, your answer will always come out to be mod x. It's because square root will always give out the principal root, that is a positive value. So even if you're doing this operation, your answer will come out to be mod of minus 4. That is 4 itself. It will not come out as minus 4. Okay. So get rid of this habit of cancellation of square root with square. So ideally, this should give you mod of 1 minus cos alpha by sine alpha. And this should also give you mod of 1 plus cos alpha by sine alpha. Okay. Now mod has a property that mod of x by y is mod x by mod y. Mod of x by y is same as mod x by mod y. So you can write it as mod of 1 minus cos alpha. Let me write equal to here. Okay, by mod of sine alpha. Similarly, this will be mod of 1 plus cos alpha by mod of sine alpha. Okay. Now, 1 minus cos alpha is a greater than equal to 0 quantity. Similarly, 1 plus cos alpha is also a greater than equal to 0 quantity. Correct? Minimum value is 0. It can always be 0 or more than 0. So, this mod becomes irrelevant for the numerators. So, it just becomes 1 minus cos alpha by mod sine alpha and 1 plus cos alpha by mod sine alpha. Remember, mod is irrelevant for a already positive quantity. So mod of x when x is positive is x itself. Okay. But what about sine alpha? Dear students, I would like to bring to your notice this fact. If you would have ignored this fact, then you will get a wrong answer. This means you are in the third quadrant. In third quadrant, sine alpha is negative. So mod of a negative quantity, as we all have seen in the bridge course, will come out to be minus of that quantity. So if this is a mistake which you have done, you will end up getting, or if you have ignored this, you will end up getting option A. So people with option A, you are wrong. Okay. Anyways, let me complete it. So if you take an LCM of minus sine alpha, you'll end up getting 1 minus cos alpha and 1 plus cos alpha. Cos alpha goes off. So the answer will be minus 2 by sine alpha. That's option B and not A. Okay. So Janta was correct actually, but still many of you gave a wrong answer to this. Okay, be aware of such things. How third, sir? It is given, no, pi to 3 pi by 2 anch, 180 to 270. Where are you when you're looking at 180 to 270 interval? Third quadrant, no? Correct, Ansh? Okay, next question. Okay, let's see who is able to answer this. Again, I'm just testing your class 10th. This is not class 12's 11th stuff, but this is a prerequisite for this. So if you are not doing well in this, probably it'll create a problem for you. Okay, so I'm putting the poll on for you. If x is 2 sine theta by 1 plus cos theta plus sine theta, then 1 minus cos theta plus sine theta by 1 plus sine theta is what? Oh, okay. Take your time, no hurry. Let's say 3 minutes have been awarded for this. If you're not able to see the poll, no worries, don't panic. Just put it on the chat box, whichever option you think is correct. Okay, somebody has answered. Nice. By the way, June mid would be your first monthly test. Okay. Topics will be whatever we have covered till date, including the bridge course topics. An official communication will be sent to you regarding that, along with the syllabus. It would be on the Learnist platform. I think Learnist platform is already known to you. You have already taken tests in class 10th on that. Yes, yes. For maths, I will include everything. Graphs, limits, derivatives, bit of integration, trigonometry, whatever has been done so far, those all would be included. JEE main pattern. That means 75 questions. 3 hours would be allotted for it. 5 questions towards the end of every subject would be integer type. You have to put some integer value. Only 2 of you have responded so far. Come on, buck up. Students, please, fast. Good, Oshik, very good. Correct, Parvati. Okay, in another 1 minute, I'm going to stop the poll. Last 20 seconds. Last 5. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, stop. Okay, so 10 of you have voted. This is the result that you have given me. Mostly Janta is saying C option. Okay, that means it will remain X. Okay, let's check. See, I can see this type of expression on the top. Okay, and a similar expression is there here also. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to shuffle. I'm going to produce this kind of a term, that is 1 plus sine theta minus cos theta over here. So let me do one thing. Just a small internal change I am making in the expression. I'm just clubbing these two together and I'm keeping cos theta separate. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to multiply with 1 plus sine theta minus cos theta, both in the numerator and denominator. Okay, so my attempt is to create this term on the numerator. Okay, so let's see what happens. In the denominator, you can see it is something like, all of you please see here, it is something like a plus b into a minus b. So that would become a square minus b square. A square minus b square, right? Now, what is this cos square? Cos square is again 1 minus sine square. Sorry for making a change here itself so that I have to write less. Okay. And 1 minus sine square is actually 1 minus sine into 1 plus sine. Correct? Correct? Now, let me do this thing. Let me take 1 plus sine theta as common. So I'll end up getting 1 plus sine theta minus this, which is minus 1 plus sine theta. Now you can see that 1 and minus 1 will cancel off. Sine theta and sine theta will make 2 sine theta, which will cancel off from here. So this entire thing is gone. So you're left with 1 plus sine theta minus cos theta by 1 plus sine theta, which is actually your same expression that you wanted to find out. So this expression is same as that of x. So option C is the right option. Option C is the right option. Now, if I were you, I would solve this question by putting a special value of theta because I wanted to see what it is coming up to. So if I were to solve this question, I would probably put theta as, you know, 90 degree or something. Okay. So if I put theta as 90 degree, but there also be careful. There also be careful because you should be able to distinguish between the options. Okay. 90 degree or probably, you know, you can put 0 degree or 30 degree, whichever you think will conveniently get to the figure. So in your examination condition, do not solve it in a rigorous way. Do not solve it in a rigorous way. Okay. For learning, go with a rigorous way, right? It's like when you are, it's like when you're practicing batting, right? Of course, you'll play all the, you know, shots, which is in the copy book, right? Cover drive, flick, whatever. But when you're in the ground, you have to score runs anyhow. Okay. You don't have to always, you know, put a cover drive for a four. So the best way to solve this question is smart substitutions for theta, period. Next. Okay. If sine theta plus cos theta is 1/5, and theta lies between 0 to pi, then tan theta is multiple options may be correct. Multiple options may be correct. Tomorrow early morning, 9 to 10:30 would be KVPY session on number theory. Those who are interested, please join that session. Very short session of 1.5 hours. Number theory is a big concept, right? We cannot do, of course, in 1.5 hours. I will have multiple sessions on number theory. So tomorrow is the first one. Please type out your response on the chat box. Okay, Aditi. Okay, Kshitij. Okay, Gurman. Okay. Okay, Anusha. Others, what do you think? Oshik, Pradyun, Priyam, Rubhav, Shanmukh, Arabi. Parvati. Kshitij has changed his answer. Okay, Kshitij, acknowledged. Okay, last 30 seconds. Please wrap this up, then we'll discuss it. Okay, let's discuss this. So the first thing that we have in front of us is sine theta plus cos theta is 1/5. Okay, so what I can do is I can bring this 5 to the left hand side. Fine. Let me square both the sides. Okay, so when you square both the sides, you end up getting 25 sine square theta. You get 25 cos square theta. And you get 50 sine theta cos theta. And remember, this 1 square is actually sine square theta plus cos square theta. So you can make use of trigonometric identity there also. So this 1 square, I wrote it up as sine square plus cos square. Correct. Now bring it to the other side, you'll end up getting 24 sine square theta plus 50 sine theta cos theta plus 24 cos square theta equal to 0. Okay. Now divide this by cos square theta throughout. And divide it by, in fact, 2 cos square theta throughout. So you'll end up getting 12 tan square theta plus 25 tan theta plus again 12 equal to 0, right? Is this factorizable? 144. 144 is 16 into 9. Yeah. So I can write this as 16 tan theta plus 9 tan theta plus 12 equal to 0. If I take 4 tan theta common here, I'll end up getting 3 tan theta plus 4. And here also, if I take 3 common, I'll get 3 tan theta plus 4. Equal to 0. So I end up getting 4 tan theta plus 3 times 3 tan theta plus 4 equal to 0. Okay. Now this leads to two conclusions. Either tan theta is equal to minus 3/4 or tan theta is equal to -4/3. Tan theta is equal to -4/3. Okay. Now at this stage, most of you, I think Kshitij made our last moment correction, but most of you went for option A and B. Okay. Now wait a minute, guys. This is a very important thing that I would like to tell you over here. At this stage, you have squared both the sides. The moment you do that, there is actually no distinction between you solving this and you solving for this. Both are covered under this guy. Correct? So there is a possibility that you have introduced extra roots into the system. Does it mean I should not square it? No, it doesn't mean that. When there is a necessity to square it, you cannot bypass it. You have to square it. But when you are squaring it, you have to bear the consequences of it. The consequences, you will introduce extra roots into the system. So when I am solving a question by squaring both the sides or by cubing both the sides or whatever power I am raising on both the sides, I need to check whether any extra roots, what is called as extraneous roots. Has any extraneous root kept into my system? That is what we need to verify and rule out. Let's check -3/4 first. Is it an extra root? Is it a root that belongs to this guy and not the original one? Right? Let's check. Now tan theta is -3/4. Sine theta will be equal to 3/5. Why not -3/5? Why not -3/5? This information will help us. You are in the first and second quadrant only, where sine is positive. In both first and second, sine is positive. Okay. But cos theta would be -4/5. If you add it, my dear, you'll get -1/5. So as I guessed, this is an extra root. So this is to be rejected. So people who marked B just because I said there is multiple option correct, you got trapped actually. It has only one answer, and that is -4/3. But still, let me confirm this as well. So when tan theta is -4/3, sine theta is going to be 4/5, and cos theta is going to be -3/5. Because you are in the first and the second quadrant only, so sine has to be positive, but cos has to be negative. Now when you add this, you'll get 1/5. So that is fitting in our original equation. So option A is the only right option. Option A is the only right option. So Kshitij is the only person who got this correct. Is that fine? So never be in a hurry to answer. Okay. Okay, let's take a few more questions. I had few questions here. Let's solve this. Let's take this up. Find the value of this expression. Value means value. Don't give me an expression itself. It should have some numeric value. So whenever any question says find the value, it means some numeric value assigned to it. That's fast. Very good. Yes, Ansh, it is 90 degree only. Okay, Auro. So as of now, Shitij and Auro has ans have answered. Let's see. Okay, Ansh. Very good, Gurman. Okay, Pradin. Okay, so most of you have tried to answer. Few of you are correct, few of you are not. See, look at this angle and this angle. What do they add up to? Any person can guess, they add up to give you pi by 2. Correct? So cos square 7 pi by 16 is as good as sine square pi by 16. Correct? Okay, complementary angle property. Right? So what is cos square? It just means square of this term. Correct? So this term inside could be written as cos or sine 90 minus this. So sine 90 minus 7 pi by 16 square, right? So that is actually this term. Okay. In the same way, this term, let me write it over here. In the same way, this term could be written as sine square 3 pi by 16. Okay. So this plus this will become a 1. This plus this will become a 1. That means your answer for this question is 2. The answer for this question is 2. Okay, not 0, not 1, it's 2. Sorry, I didn't get you. See, cos theta is sine 90 minus theta. That's what I used. So this is your theta. Okay. So I wrote it as sine 90 degree minus theta. So that will give you sine pi by 16. So this will be as good as sine square pi by 16. Cos 2 pi by 16 common. Why? How do you take that common, Auro? Cos square you are taking common. Huh? So if I take cos square pi by 16 common, what will it help me with? How? I didn't get you. You are saying we have to do this. Then? Can you unmute yourself and say that? I don't get how taking cos square pi by 16 is going to help you in any way. It doesn't give you cos 2 pi, sorry. Okay. See, most of you are applying your basic, you know, taking common and all. See, cos square is an operator. It is not an, it's not a term, it's an operator. Operator cannot be taken common. Getting my point? Okay. So I cannot say sine 30 plus sine 60. Okay. Take sine common and it'll become 30 plus 60. Okay. This doesn't work. This is absolute wrong thing. Okay. Don't do all these things. Okay. Next question. I hope you can read this question. Let me put the image down. This is a super easy question. I think you would have done questions of this nature. See, Shitej gave me the answer. The moment you look at it, probably you'll be able to get the answer. Very good. This is Sai. Sai. Okay. Very easy. Most of you have given the answer to this. See, if you multiply, let's say this expression is equal to some value k. Okay. If you multiply k with this given expression to you, okay, which is actually equal to tan theta, tan phi, tan psi. Okay. You'd realize that this into this will produce a 1. This into this will produce a 1, and this into this will produce a 1. So you end up getting a 1. That means k value is cot theta, cot phi, cot xi. So option number A becomes the right option. Very simple question. Is this fine? Any questions here? Okay. Now, let us start with the concept of compound angle identities. Compound angle identities. First of all, what is the meaning of a compound angle? That is something which we need to understand. Compound angle is nothing but more than two angle involved in sense of addition or subtraction is a compound angle. A simple example will be A plus B. It's a compound angle. It has got two angles in it. Okay. You could have A minus B also. You could have A plus B plus C also. You could have different signs also. Let's say A minus B plus C. Okay. So these are examples of compound angles. So these are compound angles. So in simple terms, if more than one angle is added, subtracted, or a mix of operations between them, you would call them as a compound angle. Okay. So now we are going to learn some compound angle identities. Okay, so I'm going to start with the derivation of this compound angle identity cos of A plus B. Okay, now there are several ways to prove it. Now I'll be taking that way which has been prescribed in your NCERT syllabus. Okay, what is that way? Let me make a diagram for you. Okay, so all of you please look at this diagram. Let's say there's a circle. Okay, it's a unit circle. Okay, on this unit circle, I take an angle A. Let's say this is angle A. Fine. Now, if this is 1, of course, this point will also be 1, 0. Now, who will tell me what is the coordinate of this point? Let me call this as P for the time being. What is the coordinate of this point P? Can somebody tell me what is the coordinate of that point P? Absolutely correct, Kshitij. That will be cos A, comma sin A. Fine, no doubt about it. Okay. Now, from this A, I increase an angle B and I reach a point Q. Fine. Who will tell me what is the coordinate of Q? What is the coordinate of Q? Very good, Kshitij. That's impressive. So, if you increase by an angle of B, the total angle becomes A plus B, and the coordinate of that point will be cos A plus B sine A plus B. Very good, Ansh. Okay. Now, I'll do the same thing now by going B down. So, let's say I go a B down from here. Okay. And I reach this position R. Okay. Now, if I go B down, it is basically taken as a negative angle. Correct. Okay. So, what do you think? B is the magnitude by which I am going down. So, basically, B is the magnitude which I am going down. So, let me call it as minus B. Okay. So, what will be the coordinates of R? No. Kshitij, that's wrong. Ansh, wrong. Anusha, wrong. Same as Q. If it is same as Q, they should be at the same point. No. Why they are different? Two points have the same coordinates. They should be at the same location. No. So it's going to be cos minus B and sine minus B. Okay, simple, fine. Yeah, correct, Anusha. Now cos minus B is as good as cos B, and sine minus B is as good as minus sine B. So we all know that. So let me make that correction over here. I'll just restructure this as cos B comma minus sine B. Okay. Now I would like you to all focus on these three triangles OPQ. And OQR, OPR. I'm so sorry. My bad. I want you to focus on this triangle. Let me name it as. Let me name this point as point S. I want you to focus on this triangle, OQS, and OPR. Okay. So everybody, focus on triangle O. QS and focus on triangle OPR. What can you comment about these two triangles? They are congruent. Absolutely. They are congruent. They are congruent. Why? Why? Because the sandwiched angle is the same, A plus B, A plus B. Okay. and the adjacent sides to that angle, okay, are both equal to the radius of the circle, which is one each. Okay, so by SAS you can say they are congruent. Okay, now if they're congruent, you would be agreeing to the fact that PR should be equal to QS. That means this length should be equal to this length. PR should be equal to QS. Agreed? No doubt about it. So what is PR? Or you can say PR square will be equal to QS square. Everybody is happy till this stage? Any question? Correct? Okay. Now, in order to find QS, I will use the distance between 2 point formula. So Q is this, S is this. What is the distance between them? So you'll say cos A plus B minus 1 the whole square, sine A plus B minus 0 the whole square. Okay, I'm not under rooting it because square is already taken to cancel that off. Is equal to QS square. QS square will be cos A minus cos B the whole square and sine A plus sine B the whole square. Hope there is no doubt about this step. Okay, so PR square is equal to QS square. Correct? Anybody has any problem with this? Now let me expand it. So this will be cos square A plus B minus 2 cos A plus B plus 1. And here I will end up getting sine square A plus B. Okay. On the right side, you'll see cos square A plus cos square B minus 2 cos A cos B. And you'll see sine square A, sine square B plus 2 sine A sine B. Okay. Now, pay attention. This plus this will become a 1. Pythagorean identity. Okay. Cos square something plus sine square the same thing will become a 1. Okay. 1 plus 1 is 2. So it will be 2 minus 2 cos A plus B. Correct? Is that fine? On the right side, what will you see? Let me remove this. On the right side, you'll see cos square A sine square A, that is also 1. Cos square B sine square B, that is also 1. And you'll end up seeing minus 2 cos A cos B minus sine A sine B. Right? Now 2 and 2 goes off. In fact, minus 2 and minus 2 will also go off. And that will lead to cos A plus B as cos A cos B minus sine A sine B. Now, this is an identity for you. It will work for any AB combination. You can take A and B to be any real number. It will work for this. Okay. So this identity is the first of your compound angle identity. This identity is your first of your compound angle identity, and the coming identities would all be dependent on this. So I'll not derive them. I will just use them to find all other identities. Okay. Now, is this the only way to prove it? No, there's one more way to prove it. I'll just take the next 4 minutes to prove it in another way, but this way has some kind of questions raised. That's why we don't tell this way to everybody, to the students in the class initially. Let's say there is a rectangle. Okay, let's say there is a rectangle. Fine. In this rectangle, let me make a right angled triangle inside like this. Okay, so this is a rectangle, and inside a rectangle there is a right angle triangle, right? let me name it as, you know, P, Q, R, S, T, and let's say M. Okay. Let's say I call this angle as angle A and I call this angle as angle B. Now, even though I'm proving it for a very constrained situation like this, right? That is why many people raise a question. They tell that, sir, you are restricting it to be within, you know, first quadrant. A and B could be in any quadrant. That's why we don't tell this proof, you know, in most of the cases. Yeah, you can write this down if you want. Okay. Now, all of you, please notice that this length is going to be 1. So please note that I have taken this length to be 1. Okay, it is my call. So I've constructed a triangle in this way that hypotenuse length is 1. Okay, so now let us try to find out the other dimensions. In the interest of time, I will write it down. This will become cos B. Okay, this will become sin B. Correct. Now, since this is angle A and this is cos B, this will become cos B sin A. Correct. And this will become cos B cos A or cos A cos B. Yes or no? Any doubts so far? Now, if this is angle A, can I say this will also be angle A? And if this is angle A and this is sine B, then this side will be, I'm just writing it over here, this side will be sine A sine B. And this side will be cos A sine B. Correct? Yes or no? Now, this is A, this is B. So this complete angle is A plus B. So this angle will also be A plus B. Correct? So it is very obvious that now this will become cos A plus B. And this will become sin A plus B. Okay, if you look at this right angle triangle over here. Right? Now see, all the identities, most of the identities will come out from here. You can see that PQ is equal to SR. PQ is equal to SR. So you can say cos A plus B plus sin A sin B is equal to SR. SR is cos A cos B. So from here we figure out that cos of A plus B is nothing but cos A cos B, cos A cos B minus sin A sin B. The same figure that we got in the previous derivation. Okay, so keep this in mind. These formulas have now to be remembered. Okay, these formulas are now to be remembered. Meanwhile, we'll stop over here. And next class would be very important class for you because I'll be dumping many, many identities on you. So we'll talk about sin A plus B, then cos A minus B, sin A minus B, tan A plus B, tan A minus B. And what if the angles are more than 2, what to do? All those things will be dealt in the next class. Okay, so next class, please do not miss out. Yeah, this has a limitation because many people can raise a question. How are you calling this as an identity? Because it is limited to angles within a 90 degree, right? Okay, so that's why we don't tell this proof many a times. But this is another way how you can look at it. This is another way. The coordinate geometry is more robust. More robust. Okay, guys, thank you so much. Bye bye. Good night. Stay safe. Thank you so much.